this is medial mediastinum. So just behind the medial mediastinum, this region, this is the posterior mediastinum. See this up to here, this whole thing. This region is the posterior mediastinum. So first we'll know the boundary of the posterior mediastinum. Then we'll go for the contents. Again, same thing. Boundary: anterior, posterior, superior, inferior, and on the two lateral side. Okay. Boundary of so the boundary again same thing. Anterior boundary. Okay. Now see here. What is there in the anterior aspect? See, heart is there, isn't it? In the upper part. See, in the lower part, diaphragm is also there. See, dome of diaphragm is also there. So this forms the anterior boundary. From here to here, this is the anterior boundary. So the anterior boundary, this is the content of the medial mediastinum, or we can directly write the pericardium and heart. Or in bracket, directly you can write medial mediastinum. And also see, in the lower part, there is the dome of diaphragm also. That also forms the anterior boundary only. From here to here, this is the anterior. So the pericardium and heart, and also the superior surface of a dome of diaphragm, that forms the anterior boundary of heart. Sorry, anterior boundary of posterior mediastinum. So this is the anterior boundary. So pericardium and heart in the upper part, in the lower part, you will see the dome of diaphragm, that forms the anterior boundary. Okay. So next is the posterior. So posterior boundary, see here, you will see. Can you see this structure? Whatever is there. So 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So from 5 to 12 thoracic vertebra. And in between each vertebra, you will see here, this is the region for the intervertebral disc. So this is the your posterior boundary for the posterior mediastinum. So the posterior boundary is formed by the T5 to T12 thoracic vertebra. And adjoining intervertebral disc. So this forms the posterior boundary. Are you listening?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is your posterior boundary. Okay. Now, next is the superior boundary and inferior boundary. So the superior boundary, what is there in the superior boundary? The same thing. So that is the transverse thoracic plane. That forms the superior boundary. So superior boundary forms by the transverse. So this transverse thoracic plane, it lies at the level of external angle anteriorly and posteriorly at the level of lower border of T4. Okay. Anteriorly external angle, posteriorly lower border of T4 vertebra. So this forms the superior boundary. Okay. See, this posterior mediastinum also communicate with the neck region through the prevertebral fascia. There is the space in, okay, just behind the prevertebral fascia. So from that space, it's communicate with the neck also through the superior mediastinum. Just remember this much. Okay. Now inferior boundary. So the inferior boundary, there is diaphragm only. Okay. So the superior surface of diaphragm. So see anterior boundary also diaphragm is there. Some part of diaphragm is there in the anterior boundary. Okay. So inferior there is again diaphragm is there. Okay. So anteriorly also diaphragm is there and inferiorly also diaphragm. So diaphragm contributes for both the boundary. Then on the either side, what is there? Mediastinal surface or pleura, mediastinal pleura, you can write surface of okay, pleura is there, inside pleura lungs is there, so the mediastinal pleura and the mediastinal surface of lungs. So that forms the boundary for the posterior mediastinum. Okay, so the anterior boundary, heart and the part of diaphragm is there. Posterior boundary, T5 to T2 thoracic vertebra and adjoining intervertebral disc. Superior boundary by the transverse thoracic plane. That plane passes along the sternal angle anteriorly, posteriorly to the lower border of the fourth thoracic vertebra. Inferiorly, there is the superior surface of the diaphragm that forms the inferior boundary. And on the either side, here is the mediastinal pleura and the mediastinal surface of the lungs. Okay. Now we'll go for the contents. Okay. What are the contents? What may be the contents? Now we'll see the picture here. Now see, these all are the content of the posterior mediastinum. Okay. So you will see here vessels, you will see vessels, you will see tube, you will see ducts, you will see nerve, you will see in duct only, nerve will lymph duct will come. Okay. Now see here vessels. What are the vessels you will see in this region? See, can you see this large vessel here? Can you see?
Yes, sir.
Okay, make the audio on one of you. See, this is the one vessels. So here vessels you will see both artery and vein. Artery and okay, so in vessels you will see both artery and vein here. See, in artery you will see the major vessels, the major greater vessels you will see, that is the aorta. Here you will see the descending part of aorta. So that is descending aorta you will see here. Okay. So see, ascending aorta you have seen in the middle mediastinum. Arch of aorta you have seen in the superior mediastinum. And now here you will see the descending aorta in the posterior mediastinum. Okay. Are you getting? So
yes, sir.
Ascending part was there, that is in the middle mediastinum. Arch of aorta you have seen in the superior mediastinum. Descending aorta you will see in the posterior mediastinum. So the in the artery you will see the descending and its branches. Okay. And again descending aorta, it has got a two part, thoracic part and the abdominal part. Here you will see the thoracic part. Okay. So the thoracic part of descending aorta and its branches you will see in this region. Okay. This is the major artery we will see in this region. So in vein also you will see some vein, you will see azygous vein. Azygous vein you will see. image I guess when you will see. And accessory as I guess you will see. Okay, so here azygous is here. Okay, here you can see in the right side. Similarly, this hemiazygous and the accessory azygous you will see in the left side here. Oh, in picture it is not given here. Okay, so these are the vein you will see here. So azygous vein, hemiazygous, and the accessory azygous vein you will see in this region. Okay, so these all vein that drain the blood from the wall of the trunk. Okay, especially posterior wall of the trunk. Okay, so they are the azygous veins. Just remember, they drain the blood from the wall of the trunk region. Okay, so these are the veins: azygous, hemiazygous, accessory azygous veins you will see in this region. Okay, are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Now the next tube, you will see the only you will see the food pipe here. Okay, so trachea now you will not see here. Okay, so the trachea you have seen in the superior vein. Yes, you know, and the termination of the trachea into and division of the trachea into right and left principal bronchi you have seen in the medial mediastinum. Okay, so trachea ends there only. Now the but the esophagus you will see in the superior mediastinum also, and it continue up to the abdominal cavity. So you will see this esophagus in the posterior mediastinum also. So the tubes you will see in here is the esophagus. Esophagus you will see. See, if you are writing the vein means you can write the tributaries also. Azygous vein, hemiazygous vein, accessory azygous vein and its tributaries. Okay. If you are writing the artery means just you write artery and its branches. Okay. That is sufficient. No need to write the name of the branches. This azygous vein, hemiazygous, accessory azygous, they have got the tributaries. Many tributaries are there. Okay. So you can write the azygous vein, hemiazygous vein, accessory azygous, and their tributaries. Okay, I'll add here. And their tributaries you will see. So the tube you will see is the esophagus you will see here. Then the duct you will see is the, can you see this green color beaded duct? So this is the thoracic duct. Okay, that is the lymphatic duct only, large lymphatic duct. So this is the thoracic duct. Okay, are you getting? Then in nerve you will see the vagus nerve. You will see here right and left vagus nerve, and one more you will see phrenic nerve. You will see then one more nerve is there, greater and lesser splanchnic nerve. You will see. I will tell about that. Okay. So the vagus, right and left vagus. Okay. This I will write. Right and left. Right and left vagus, phrenic nerve also same, right and left phrenic nerve. Phrenic nerve you will see, and the major next nerve you will see is the greater and lesser splanchnic nerve. And one more structure you will see is the right and left sympathetic trunk. Right and left so they are the main nervous structure you will see here. So right and left vagus, see right and left vagus from, because this vagus nerve that is the parasympathetic supply for all the viscera, thoracic cavity, abdominal cavity and the organ in the pelvic cavity. So it has to go from neck to thoracic cavity, means that is the superior mediastinum also, it has to pass from the posterior mediastinum to reach in the abdominal cavity. So right and left vagus will be here in the posterior mediastinum. Again, here is the phrenic nerve. Phrenic nerve is there to supply the diaphragm. Okay, you know this thing. A greater and lesser splanchnic nerve. See, parasympathetic nerve supply is already there by the vagus, but we need the sympathetic supply also. So these are the sympathetic fiber for the viscera. Okay. So from the thoracic spinal segment. These nerves, they will arise. Okay, lower five thoracic segment. See, because sympathetic supply, they are from the T1 to L2 spinal segment only. Okay, T1, T2, T3, T45, T6, T7, T8, T9, T10, T11, T12, and L1 and L2 spinal segment. While reading the spinal cord, you will got to know. So spinal segments, from these segments, the sympathetic outflow will occur that supplies all the viscera. Okay, so see, so that forms the greater and the lesser splanchnic nerve. That is the sympathetic outflow only. And next one is the right and left sympathetic trunk. For right and left sympathetic trunk, I will show one picture. Okay. Okay. Let us see one picture from Google. Okay. So before forming the this splanchnic nerve, okay, they will first form the ganglia, sympathetic ganglia. Okay, chain of sympathetic ganglia they will form here. Okay. Now we'll see the sympathetic chain here. Okay. It's not visible. Okay. Can you see this diagram here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, it is not needed here, but this terminology I am going to make you understand here. See here. See, I have already explained you, na? Sympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic nervous system, that is outflow from the thoracic and the lumbar spinal segment. So that spinal segment, they are from T1 to L2 spinal segment. Now see in this picture. See, T1 to T2 bell is there, and up to L2 spinal segment. Okay, so these all fiber, they are coming as a sympathetic out. They will form ganglia. They will form the chain of ganglia. Can you see this chain from cervical, thoracic to lumbar? See, this is the chain. Can you see this chain? It will be in the right side of the vertebral column also. Left side of the vertebral column also. Okay, this is parasympathetic. This is the parasympathetic. Okay, one half they have given parasympathetic, one half they have given the sympathetic. But this will be in this side also, and this will be in this side also. Okay, on the both side. So this is the this chain. Can you see this? This is the chain. So this is the sympathetic chain. Okay, it will be on the right side also, left side also, here also, in the right side also, left side also. So this is the sympathetic chain. Okay, that is formed by the outflowing fiber of the sympathetic fiber from the T1 to L2 spinal segment. Now see, after forming this sympathetic chain, they will give out the fiber. They will give out sympathetic fiber for the viscera. See, in the abdominal region, they will give the bundle of the nerve. They are the greater splanchnic and the lesser splanchnic nerve only. These branches, this bundle, okay, they are the splanchnic nerve. Okay, after emerging from the sympathetic chain, they have got a name, splanchnic nerve. Okay, so before, see the fiber, they are coming from the spinal segment, then they will form this chain of ganglia extending from above downward on the both side. Okay, so that is the sympathetic chain. This is the sympathetic chain only. Okay, so this also you will see in the which mediastinum?
Posterior.
You will see this in the posterior mediastinum. Okay, so where else you will see the splanchnic is that? Okay, so greater and lesser splanchnic now. So again, this is the parasympathetic fiber. Okay. Sorry, simplify it, right? Sympathetic chain means that is a sympathetic chain. Okay, then the are you getting content?
Yes.
So nerve you will see, artery you will see, vein you will see, duct you will see. Okay, and the duct is the thoracic duct you will see, and other structures you will see the lymph node also. Okay, mediastinal group of lymph node also you will see in this. Okay, lymph nodes. Group of mediastinal group of lymph nodes also you will see in this region. Okay, they are the major content in the posterior mediastinum. Okay, if you remember this picture, it is easy. Okay, just remember the tube. One tube is there that extends from neck also and in the superior mediastinum, and that passes along the posterior mediastinum, that is esophagus. You will see here. Now one tube, trachea, using the superior mediastinum, and if you bifurcate into the right and left principal bronchi, but that lies in the medial mediastinum. Vagus nerve you will see in the superior mediastinum, then in the posterior mediastinum. Phrenic nerve you will see in the superior also, posterior also. You will see the greater splanchnic nerve in the posterior mediastinum only. You will see the sympathetic chain right and left from the posterior only. You will see the thoracic duct in the posterior mediastinum, and the terminal part you will see in the superior mediastinum also. Like that. Okay. So one more vessels you will see in this region is the posterior mediastinum, that is the azygous vein, hemiazygous vein, and the accessory azygous vein also. Okay, so they are the contents for the posterior mediastinum. Okay, these are the boundary and the content of the individual mediastinum. Okay, now we'll go for the some clinical anatomy also. Okay, now they are the applied aspect of the clinical anatomy. Now almost mediastinum is over. Okay, now we'll see some clinical anatomy related to the mediastinum. One is the mediastinal syndrome. Next one is the mediastinitis. Mediastinitis is the inflammation of the mediastinum, content of the mediastinum. Okay, see, actually see, mediastinum, it communicate with the neck, that is the retropharyngeal space of the neck. Okay, through the pretracheal and the paravertebral space. There is the fascia around the trachea, that is the pretracheal fascia is there, and there is the fascia just in front of the vertebra, that is the paravertebral fascia. So the space between this fascia, through this space only, the mediastinum will communicate with the neck region. So there is the direct communication is there. Okay, first superior mediastinum will communicate to the neck, then through the superior posterior will communicate. So see, so the communication is there means if any infection in the neck region is there means it may descend to the mediastinum also. Okay, are you getting?
Yes, sir.
So the brachial fascia. So retropharyngeal. Now see, there is a trachea around, fascia around the trachea, pretracheal fascia, just in front of the vertebra there is a fascia, that is the paravertebral fascia. So in the space between this fascia, the mediastinum communicate with the retropharyngeal space. Just behind the pharynx, there is this space. Now that is the neck region, just you remember, neck region. So there is a communication between these two. So if any infection is in the neck region is there, if communication is there, means this may descend, no? this infection may migrate to the mediastinum, so it may lead to the mediastinitis. So this is the inflammation of the mediastinum. Okay, are you getting? Thus you can write mediastinitis and inflammation of the content of the mediastinum. That is sufficient. Okay, for understanding only I am explaining this, how this is going to occur. Okay, so mediastinitis means inflammation of the content of the mediastinum. Okay, inflammation of the content of the mediastinum or inflammation of the mediastinum is the mediastinitis. Now next is there mediastinal syndrome. Mediastinal syndrome is, it is the group of symptom. Okay, syndrome means group of symptoms. That means the group of, so the mediastinal syndrome, you see, if any, see this mediastinum, it is the potential space. There is actually, there is no space. This space is occupied by the various structures. You have already seen the content in the each mediastinum. So there is actually, there is no space only. Okay, so see, if any tumor arises in the mediastinum, okay, then what will happen? If any tumor is there, there is no space to for that tumor. So if any growth is there, then what will happen? It may compress the surrounding structure, isn't it? If there is no space and if any tumor is growing there, means it will compress the surrounding structures, isn't it? So by, if this tumor is going to compress the vein, like because vein are there in the mediastinum, if tumor is going to compress the vein, then what will happen? The vein, see, lumen is there in the vein. If not, tumor will compress this, the lumen will close. Then what will happen? The venous return will be obstructed. Okay, if venous return from the upper part of the body is obstructed, means blood from the upper part which is not able to go in the heart. If blood is not able to go to the heart, then what will happen? The vein in the upper part will become dilated, isn't it? So that is the engorgement of the vein of the upper part of the body. So if any growing tumor is there, it may compress the surrounding structure. Whatever is there in the surrounding of that tumor, it will compress that. If that tumor is compressing a vein, means the blood flow is obstructed. If blood flow is obstructed, the vein is dilated, because more blood is accumulated in the vein, so blood vein is dilated. If this tumor is going to compress the trachea, what will happen? If trachea is compressed, means it, you will feel difficulty in breathing, isn't it? So that's the dyspnea. Okay, so if tumor is compressing the trachea, that is windpipe, then that is, you will feel difficulty in breathing. So this difficulty in breathing is dyspnea. See, if the tumor is, growing tumor is compressing the your esophagus, means what will happen? You will feel difficulty in swallowing the food, isn't it? So the difficulty in swallowing food means that is the dysphagia. Okay, are you getting?
Yes, sir.
So if tumor is compressing the nerve, that is the left recurrent laryngeal nerve, because left recurrent laryngeal nerve that supplies your voice box. That voice box, that is for production of the sound. So if that tumor is going to compress that left recurrent laryngeal nerve, means your voice will change. That is, hoarseness of voice will occur. Okay. If that tumor, growing tumor, is going to compress that phrenic nerve, there is the paralysis of the diaphragm. Okay. If that growing tumor is going to compress the intercostal or subcostal nerve, then what will happen? There is the neuralgia. Neuralgia means the pain. Okay. Pain related to the nerve. Okay. If any compression for the nerve is there, there may be the pain along the